We're at Cape Cod Panel this morning for our 45 white oak project. Safe to say that just about everything is ready for us to start framing on the job site. We have all of the walls out here in the yard prepped and ready to go. There's one last bundle being fabricated, and our entire roof is actually already pre-cut, ready to go. So we're gonna head inside, talk to Mark. I wanna talk about why we chose to panelize everything in a shop rather than frame this house on site. Mark, so you guys are on the last bundle of our 45 white oak project.
Yep.
Behind us, you got a tiger saw,
yep.
All this material coming in. I wanna walk through kind of how your process works in terms of the shop.
Okay.
But before we do that, you know, you're partner, owner at Cape Cod Panel, and you're also the designer.
Yep.
And you have been working with our team, primarily the guys that are possible through a really complicated structure.
Yeah.
Take me back a little bit in terms of like, what that process looked like and why it's so important to this.
It was probably one of the more complicated ones that we've done. Trying to get all the structurals to marry with the architecturals was pretty tough, but you know, a couple of months of working, you know, with the architects who were, I mean, unbelievable on this project. We were able to work out all the bugs way ahead of time, prior to when we're in the field, which is huge, because you know, those kind of things in the field, when you know, if you're making a change in the field, your guys are standing there and it gets hard, so. Just being able to model everything so far in advance, be able to produce a cut list. When we run it through this here, here's the scrap that we end up with.
Right. So we're talking anything under 12 inches, essentially.
Yeah, and really all of this stuff right here is gonna be used out in the yard. So it's not actually gonna go in the trash can.
As pieces come in off that cut list, this is a tire stop.
Yep.
So they're printing a label, it gets cut, that label gets taken off and placed in there.
Yep, exactly. So. You know, all the parts are gonna have a label on them, and it's gonna let you know the wall number, it's gonna let you know the size, the job, you know, and whatever it is. If it's a, you know, if it's a jack or a king or, you know, it's gonna have it right on there. So when it goes to the line, there's not a lot of room there for error.
Wall number, part number, ID, and what bundle this goes to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because these guys are trained on that system.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
So as we work our way through, everything gets stacked here,
yep.
You know, for your walls. And then I think it goes to this section here.
Yep, it does. So it comes over here and it gets a layout on it. And actually right now we're in the process of, over there is a new saw that's actually gonna do all the layout. It's got an inkjet on it. So all this is gonna be eliminated now.
So no more manual Sharpies.
Right.
Save you money on the thousands of Sharpies you get to buy a year.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's what, I actually saw that as I walked
yep.
in, so they were setting that up.
We still cut all the wall plates on this saw here, but what we're gonna do from here on out is, you know, everything else over here is gonna be cut, and then all the wall plates, any of the studs like inside of a gable or, you know, or anything like that is going to be cut on that saw over there.
So that's an all-in-one. That's doing these two things in one
yep.
saw. One of the questions I got was why are we fabricating the panels off-site? And I know why I am, but you know, when someone asks you that, like, hey, you know, why not just bring this stuff to the site, fabricate it on the deck of the first floor, it's the same thing. What's your argument for that?
With the walls being framed in a controlled environment, you know, I'm able to get a model up, you know, in 3D and 2D, I'm able to work out all the bugs. So all those things that kind of, you know, hang you up in the field, we're able to catch way ahead of time. When these walls are done, throw them on a truck and they go to site, all the guessing is out of the equation. Also in the Northeast, you know, the rain and the weather is a big thing.
Yeah.
So when it gets to the site, it's just a go, go, go. I think another big thing is the amount of lumber on a job site. Sometimes lumber really, there's a lot of waste, you know, and it depends on, you know, who the framing crew is. I've seen projects with twice the amount of lumber was ordered as was actually used on the project. And a lot of it ends up in the dumpster on the ground. You know, you can't return it. You know, there's a cost savings on the lumber as well.
When you're planning this all the way out in the beginning and you're thinking about using like an automatic saw like that, you're essentially maximizing what you're able to get out of every piece of
yep.
lumber. Essentially the program knows like, hey, there's a 24 inch piece that we could then cut up for 2 10 inches.
Right.
And now we only have a 4 inch scrap and,
yep.
and your small trash can, that's what you end up with scrap.
Yep.
They're working on what we're calling our service walls,
yep.
service cavities. And they're utilizing these sections as well as basically moving them on the outside.
Yep.
I'm looking at that garage door. It looks like that's the maximum height wall we can frame through that wall, that door.
Pretty much, yep.
That brings up, what are the maximum dimensions that you could be building these panels in?
Depends on the delivery driver, if he has a wide load or not. Usually we try to keep everything around like 10'6".
Okay. And that's a wide load?
No.
No, it's not?
Nope.
Got it.
So when we do have a driver that has a permit for a wide load, we can usually get up to about like 12'3", I think it is.
So you can go over road with 10'6"?
Yep.
Okay. I always thought it was 8'6".
Nope.
So, then I'm learning something. Why don't we go out front?
Yep.
I'm kind of talking about something that we can't look at.
Yep.
Before we get out there, what's this section here?
It's kind of where we do all the gables and the big stuff. For your job, it actually, it didn't have any gables on it, which is really, really rare in the Northeast.
Yeah.
Usually a lot of our projects, there's quite a bit of gables in them, so.
Being that we have these service walls, we essentially have kind of double walls
yep.
everywhere. And this right here, all these 2x4 walls, I'm actually assuming with the PT sill, this is probably for our basement.
That is probably for the basement, yep.
Talk to me about basement walls, because these are being prefabricated as well.
Yep.
What are the tolerances that you know we need to live up to in order to make sure that these walls fit?
Within a quarter inch.
Yeah, these are showing up, working its way through the foundation, in our case, the big garage door.
Yep.
Are these all the walls, or are there any walls that get framed on site?
Every wall on your project all got framed here in the shop.
Within a quarter inch.
Yep.
And then we have our exterior walls here. So
yep.
Typical half inch CDX.
Yep.
2x6 wall.
Yep.
Do you guys deal with any of the WRB here, or will that all be done on site?
That'll all be done on site.
Yeah. Truthfully, like, I like the idea of doing it in the shop, but I actually like doing it on site more, because it's essentially, you've got the box.
Yep.
It's like wrapping a present on.
Right, exactly.
You know, you're just like, everything's done, everything's detailed. You're not going back and blasting nails through it because you forgot to nail something.
Right.
It's like, you know, it's done. Now you can go through and detail it. But what about in the way this stuff gets stacked or even shipped? Is that a consideration that you're making in the model?
Yes, absolutely. For the most part, it's the area that it goes in. So, you know, I'll try to keep all the walls in a stack or generally going to be in the same area. You know, everything is in order. So as the framer on site is working around the exteriors in the field, he's able to pull off the top and, you know, everything is going to be in order.
So when he's pulling that wall, he knows that that wall can go in first.
Yep.
Is this wall and the service wall being installed at the same time?
Yes.
It is. Yeah.
Yep.
Forecast, we're essentially building our first floor deck and then all of our exterior walls and interior walls and then the second floor deck.
Yes.
Got it.
Yep.
So you're doing really that whole floor, where oftentimes in more traditional, you're framing the exterior as fast as possible to get the deck on.
Yep.
And then you're coming back and doing your infill.
Yeah, and the bearing walls.
Right.
And I think a lot of the reason for that, I mean, especially in the Northeast, is because of the strapping.
Yeah.
Framers usually like to run the strapping all the way through, and then they build all the interiors that are, you know, if they're a non-load bearing,
yeah,
they're going to build that up to the strapping. That isn't what we chose to do here.
Mm-hmm.
Just because your project has a lot of dropped ceilings, so there's not as much strapping in your project as there is in other ones around here.
Yeah, yeah, you're not dealing with a flat ceiling, and when you are, it's essentially fake.
Right.
Where,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I think my understanding of where kind of strapping all stemmed from is that you were attaching, you know, or prepping for plaster on the bottom side of a structural, say, ceiling or floor system.
Yep.
And that strapping gave you the opportunity to kind of, you know, shim and make that ceiling
yep.
flat. Where,
yep.
like you said, we have drop ceiling, so we have the opportunity to almost frame that flat anyway.
Yep, absolutely.
Are we still planning on using strapping?
In some areas, yes. Other areas, no. I mean, obviously in the kitchen and the living area in yours, that's a pretty interesting detail. In fact, the first time I opened up the plans, it took me a little bit to wrap my head around what was going on there.
So, all right, I actually want to talk about that. But in the kitchen, as Mark said, in the kitchen and the living room, we have these oak beams. We will talk more about the detail of the oak finish in a future episode, but from a framing perspective, one of the things I said to Mark, I was like, hey, FYI, these wrap the actual TGIs
right.
on the project. So the spacing in which you see in those renderings is not fake.
No.
It needs to be dead on. I understand from like a model perspective, but how is that getting communicated to the field to know that, hey, these can't move a quarter inch. These have to be where they are.
Right. So so the way it's being communicated is I made a lot of layouts on your house. Mm. You know, usually I'll just do the layouts on the walls. I have as many layout pages as pages in the architectural plans, I think. So
I think you might have more at this point.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of annotations. We're going to have a pre-construction meeting, and we're really going to sit down and, you know, hammer out all these details, you know, to make sure that everything is right on the money. Because especially in those areas, all those joists have to be perfect.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a little... it's a little scary, especially because I know that you're gonna have it on blast all over social media, so we gotta make sure
I said this to someone in the office the other day. I was like, you know what, there's something like bittersweet about working on the verge of anxiety,
because
it really pushes you to challenge the way that you think, but also like the way your team thinks. But that's ultimately what, you know, we're trying to accomplish here, is something that like isn't easily accomplished. And I think that people will really start to understand the complexity of what we're doing and kind of the, you know, the sweetness of it. But a really big reason why we chose to work with you guys in terms of like, hey, the only way we can pull this off, like truly pull this off and not have a screw up in the field is we have to think about this. And going through that whole process and modeling it and understanding what that, you know, what the structure truly looks like to a component list, you know, is truly the only way we can really get there.
There's not a lot of room for error anywhere on your project.
Everything
is so well thought out. I mean, you know, even down to, you know, all of the layouts for the lighting and everything else. I mean, you know, everything is just it. There's only one place that each piece of lumber in that house is able to go.
I've looked at the window shop drawings 1,000 times. I know how big these are on paper. What is this for?
So this is...
Because this is a big-ass opening.
This is one of your windows. This panel is kind of interesting. There's not a lot of there's not a lot of bones to it.
There's like $27 worth of material in this thing.
Right, so over here, what's the name of the shear panels you guys are using? The Simpson W. So
we'll put it up on the screen.
So this is gonna be a shear panel, and that's gonna be a shear panel over there. I was gonna have the guys in the field frame this wall, but then I thought with everything that's going into this, and you know, this is a big window, it's gonna get recessed into the floor. We got a shear panel here, we got a shear panel there, and there's literally no, there's no wiggle room on each side. So I just decided to frame it here to give the guys, you know, a little bit of a guideline. And then actually what's gonna happen is this is one of the few walls that I took all the way down to the foundation. And then this is gonna be built back up in the field, I think 7/8 of an inch.
Yep.
So that, well, no, it would be 1.5 7/8. So 2 3/8.
Really, you know, efficient with dimensional lumber stock.
Right. Yep. Yep. So yeah, you know, and we're doing that so it allows, you know, the window to be recessed in the floor, so
because our floor our floor system hangs on our foundation, so the reality is like your door is buried down here and our wood floor is probably somewhere up here. Even the window shops, those took months to go back and forth, and we were talking micro details that were changing to the point where at the very last minute everything worked. And they added a flitch beam, and I think you had questioned it on one of our calls, and the flitch beam was essentially added based on the fact that the way the clip works on the window would potentially flex in a way that the door would be, it wouldn't not work, it would just be harder to pull in a worst case scenario of a fully loaded roof in the dead of winter. And but that was like, I remember being in that meeting, and it's super frustrating because it's like we're so close and you want to frame and we want to move, and but you realize those conversations where it's like that could have just been overlooked and it probably would have been fine, but the one time that the homeowner pulls that door and it sticks for a minute and they're like, that's weird, like it just immediately triggers like something's wrong. And at the end of the day, it ends up costing $500 for a piece of steel to be added to the backside of that header. And,
right.
And we prevent that from ever being an issue.
Right, yeah.
Last thing, I want to go back to the roof. You said that the whole roof has been pre-cut.
Yes.
So all the rafters, all the beams, everything?
Yep, everything.
Are you able to pre-cut a roof because you're holding such tight tolerance on where those walls will end up?
Yes.
And is there any wiggle room?
A little bit. An eighth to a quarter.
Okay. So the roof is made up of both structural LVL and dimensional stock.
Yep.
And I assume that these are some of the big beams.
These are some of the big beams. Yep. All these are hips. This looks like a ledger that's going to wrap around the service area that you have up on the roof there.
Yeah. So we have essentially on the main part of the house, a hip roof. But in the middle of that, it actually drops down to a recessed flat roof.
Yep.
And that's actually where we have a 9-foot by 9-foot skylight, which I also laid out the other day, which I was like, holy shit, that's big.
Yeah. Oh, it's huge.
It's big, and it's one piece of glass. You look at the stuff on paper for so long, and you almost forget how big it is.
Yep.
And then, we were at a job, and there was like a big skylight. It was 4-foot by 4-foot. I'm like, wow, that's really big. And I'm like, wait. We have a 9 by 9.
Yeah.
Again, back to the model, like all of this is modeled.
Yep.
I'm looking at like small details where this is just, tapered off the end. That's probably because there's an impact point.
Yep, it's gotta be there to fit.
I was primarily a finished carpenter and I've framed a few roofs, but never very complicated roofs. To see it be done in a model and then be put together off site and then to watch it go up and I'll say it's gonna go together as it should is just like, for me, that's really impressive because it's not straightforward. It's very it's complicated.
Yep. It was an interesting roof to put together. I'm really excited to see it all go together. I've spent numerous hours really going through the model to make sure that as soon as we hit the field, everything goes exactly to plan, exactly like it is in the model.
Yeah.
So,
and then behind us, I gotta ask, what, Joker 2?
So that's gonna be the common that goes on the end of the ridge. So you got a ridge like this, and then you got a common that goes up to it.
Okay.
So
what's the Joker mean?
That's just, I guess, what I've always called it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Uh-huh. All right, a little tidbit from Mark's brain.
Yeah, I mean, it may be a Nebraska thing.
Okay.
So.
We'll find out. Lastly, this is impressive to see. We were chatting, just a couple weeks ago, and I didn't even realize you were starting fabrication. I was chatting with the guys from Motif. I'm like, hey, we got to go film. And we show up today, and they have one bundle left. They're flying through this.
Yeah.
On site right now, we're prepping for you guys, basically committing to a week from next Monday.
Okay.
And from that time frame to basically completion of structure, I don't want to speak for you, but I think it's a month.
Probably a little bit less, but I'll say a month just to be safe.
Yeah.
There's also quite a bit of exterior strapping on that place.
Yes.
Which I
would consider completely separate from the structure.
Yeah.
Like
your
structure plywood box essentially prepped ready for WRB. So you're saying just under a month.
Structure should be up in, I would say just under a month.
Cool.
Yep.
Well, Mark, I know that this was complicated, but I appreciate you guys sticking through it.
Yep, you bet.
We have another one in the works.
All right.
Well, hopefully two more in the works that we've chatted about.
Yep.
So it's exciting to have a good partner like you guys.
Looking forward to it.
Awesome. Thanks, Mark.
Yep.
Guys, stay tuned. We'll be on site in, like I said, 2 weeks, framing this, getting this house stood up. We'll make sure that we capture that entire thing. But if you have questions about this process or anything, make sure you drop them in the comments below. And we'll see you in the next video.